Now we'll be moving on to those diseases which are not specific for certain region. For example, they're not specifically affecting the physis, epiphysis, or the metaphysis, but they are so called as mixed abnormalities. That is, the effect they can affect any region of the bone. And these include pseudoachondroplasia, dystrophic and cleidocranial dysplasia, and Neil patella syndromes. So coming to the pseudoachondroplasia, this why it's called as pseudoachondroplasia because it's kind of a mimics achondroplasia but not affecting the physis, but it can affect the other regions as well. It's a short limb dysplasia associated with significant short stature, limb malalignment, and severe ligamentous laxity. It's an autosomal dominant like achondroplasia but affects comp gene like multiple epiphyseal dysplasias. There's a disruption in comp secretion, accumulation in chondrocytes, and eventually leading to cell death. Inhibition of epiphyseal growth. That's why which leads to short stature. The clinical features include average height is around 120 centimeter, which is around 4 to 4.5 feet. Striking clinical feature is ligamentous laxity, which is diagnosed on Batten scoring. The other includes polyaxial instability, means usually the knee could be posterior lateral, anterior lateral instability, rotator instability, or there will be associated posterior lateral, anterior lateral instability. Then effect on the epiphyseal growth is always present during the short stature. The early onset of arthritis and cartilage attrition affects articular cartilage formation as well because it's osteochondrodysplasia subtype. And flat epiphyses with mild metaphyses, usually seen on X-rays, and the bones are usually seen as short tubular bones. There may be, because the bones are weak, there may be associated mechanical axis anomaly. Coming to the orthopedic management, again, it's a genetic component disease. It's a disease. You cannot treat the genes, but yes, you can treat the malalignment and weakness of the bone. So management includes the physiotherapy, analgesics to relieve pain, anti-inflammatory drugs to reduce further swelling and associated pain with the disease, then multiple osteotomy depending on different level, and last is if the joint has become too arthritic, probably the treatment of choice is joint replacement. Now coming to the dystrophic dysplasia, it's an autosomal recessive. Again, it can affect any region of the bone. It's not specific for physis, epiphysis, or metaphysis. It is secondary to mutation in a SLC26A2 gene. This is due to defect in sulfate transport protein, abnormalities of cartilage protoglycan as well. Rare incidence is highly rare, usually 1 in 10, 1 million, almost 100,000 is always there. Clinical features include short stature, cleft palate, and cauliflower-like ears, hitchhiker's thumbs, and associated with usually foot includes talipes, spinal manifestations. There may be plantar instability, hyperkyphosis, spinal cord compression, and cervical and thoracolumbar kyphosis and scoliosis. Then may include limb involvement such as rhizomelic or mesomelic shortening, genivalgum, hip and knee contractures, foot deformities such as right club foot or skew foot. The diagnosis and the treatment is radiographs usually show epiphyseal hyperplasia, metaphyseal widening, genivalgum and scoliosis, widening of the first metacarpal. The treatment again, as it is a disease with a genetic component, so we are treating the complication as well. Maybe an initial treatment includes correction of the joint contractures, which could be either via physiotherapy or surgically. Then physiotherapy is always there, which not only corrects the joint contractures but also helps the patient to ambulate. Then in case if it presented with talipes foot, then probably surgery has to be performed to make it a plantigrade foot so that the patient can walk. Other include if it is representing with acromegaly instability, then probably occipitocervical fusion is the choice because it gives spine enough stability so that eventually no neurological compromise will be happening later on in life. Now coming to the last of these three, that is cleidocranial dysplasias. Now, they affect bones found by intramembranous ossifications, and as you know, facial bones, the bones of the head and skull usually are formed by the intramembranous ossifications. That is why it's mainly affect the facial and the cranial bones. It's autosomal dominant inheritance. Mutation is RUNX2 gene. It's associated with short stature with dysplastic and absent clavicles. Usually, if you see this X-ray, the clavicle is classically absent. Shoulder hypermobility and coxavara and shortening of the middle phalanges, late closure of fontanelle, frontal bossing and vermin bones especially seen. There is associated dental abnormalities with delayed eruption as well. So once the diagnosis has been made, the radiographs, as you can see it over in the chest X-ray, this is the shoulder joint. There is no clavicle which is connecting the and forming sternoclavicle junction. Dental abnormalities can also be seen, and usually short neck associated with these problems. Mainly asymptomatic, no sensible surgical treatment is available. Realignment osteotomy only if coxavara. Now the point is, if the patient does not have a clavicle, you cannot put in a clavicle. But the point is, until unless some kind of a complication is done, for example in case of coxavara or malalignment, then only the treatment is directed against that complication, but not against the disease. Coming to the nail patella syndrome, again, it's a very rare disease, autosomal dominant, but by definition, you would remember that there's something which affects the nail and the patella, but it can also affect elbow as well as other joints as well. There are random mutations of LMX1B gene. Clinical features include knee instability, as the name suggests, the nail patella syndrome, limited elbow movement, usually due to hyperextension, something, subluxation of radial head is also associated and causing the limited elbow movement, and exostosis of iliac horns. When you get an X-ray of the pelvis, especially pedunculated growth in the ilium can be seen. Scoliosis and scapular hyperplasia. They may be associated with spinal deformities in form of scoliosis, and nephropathy and glaucoma may also be present. So diagnosis is classically, usually it's made basis of family history. Hallmark is digital and patellar abnormalities, UNF planes, radiographs and CT and MRI. Classical treatment is analgesics, physiotherapy, patellar realignment if it is needed, and radial head excision if it is actually subluxating again and again, leading to elbow instability. Now in this we have just discussed those diseases, for example, which are affecting not specifically the said region, but they can affect physis, epiphysis or metaphysis, or any region of the bone. But again, the point is that these skeletal dysplasias usually have a genetic component. So the main aim of the treatment is treating the complication, not the disease. Thank you very much. Keep watching Skadi.com.